Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God, Jesus, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Almighty
and merciful God, it is only by your gift that your faithful people offer you true and laudable service. Grant that we may run without stumbling to obtain your heavenly promises through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Rescue the oppressed, defend the orphan, plead for the widow. Come now, let us argue it out, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be like snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. to the Church of the Thessalonians in God our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace from God our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ. We must always give them thanks to God for you, brothers and sisters. Has right because your faith is growing abundantly, and their love of everyone of you and another is increasing. Therefore, we ourselves boast of you among the churches, of God for your steadfastness and faith during all your oppressions and the afflictions that you are enduring. To the end, we will always pray for you, asking that our God will make you worthy of his call and will fulfill by his power every good resolve and work of faith, so that the name of our Lord Jesus Christ may be glorified in you and you in him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the people.
Thanks be to God.
Savior, Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man there named Zacchaeus was a chief tax collector and was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd he could not, because he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him, because he was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today." So he hurried down and was happy to welcome him. All who saw it began to grumble and said, "He's gone to be the guest of the man who is a sinner." Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, "Look, half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much." Then Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because he too is a son of Abraham, and for the Son of Man to come to seek out and to save the lost." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Thank you.
Please be seated. You ever try to figure out what's wrong with the world? I have a theory. I keep trying to come up with theories about it, you know, like maybe this is what's wrong, maybe that's what's wrong. And I'll share this theory I have a little bit later. That's sort of a working theory now, based on today's gospel. I want the world to repent. I want communists and capitalists, Republicans and Democrats, rich and poor, young and old, atheists and theists, to all repent. But I'm also aware of one simple truth. Repentance starts with me. Now, some of you are very familiar that I have a different view of repentance and sin, which I think is basically based in the original meaning in the Greek. I've said before in a sermon that sin is the word harmatia in Greek actually is an archery term, and it means missing the mark. You're off target, all right? Repentance is getting back on target. But when the Puritans got hold of those words, they went Stephen King on them. And somehow it took off to become, you know, the fires of hell and evil to the very core kind of stuff of your being. I have to use this. This is my Puritan Bible. And for those of you that thought the Pirate Eucharist was at 10 o'clock, it was at 9, but I didn't want you to miss the Puritan Bible. The Puritan Bible is that kind of religion. And if you think that you change or other people change, if you hit them hard enough with judgment and condemnation, good luck. It doesn't start that way. And today's reading reminds us of what repentance can actually look like. Repentance happens when you're flooded with love, acceptance, forgiveness. When you feel that you belong and that you're welcome, included. And not because you've hidden part of yourself from those who include you, but because you are seen and understood and still loved and accepted. Because you're seen. You know, puritanical repentance leaves one feeling utterly bad about oneself. It's not understanding or illuminating or compassionate. It's condemning and can cause one to go away depleted. When I see what happens to Zacchaeus, that famous line from When Harry Met Sally comes to mind, I'll have some of that. I'll have what he's having. Because look at him. He's filled with joy. He's transformed. Jesus never says a judgmental thing on him. He just invites him, welcomes him, includes him. He knows his name. He says, I don't want to just be with you. I want to go into your house, in a place where you live, and sit with you, and eat with you. That is radical inclusion. No judgment. Nothing. Not a word of judgment. And he is able to choose change because of love. He's seen, he's understood, he's celebrated. So if we put our dire need to change before receiving love, we're not going to get anywhere. So the question is, are you receiving love? Are you receiving, what does that look like for you? How does that happen? How do you receive love? Well, I think some of this is about the child. I think that if you read the story, you cannot help but think about the child. Why do I say that? Because children climb trees, not executives. This is about a big shot, or well-known leader, if you want to call him that, in the community, official, climbing a tree. He climbs up a tree. He is described as someone with diminished stature. Okay? He's little. So if you think about this little guy who can't see what's going on, you get kind of this childlike imagery. Like, can't see it. I'm going to climb the tree. I'm going to go over there and climb the tree so I can see what's going on. It's an engagement in a child's activity that brings this transformation, initiates this transformation. And so you can imagine the ridicule, the jokes, the hurt that maybe Zacchaeus encountered growing up. In some way, all of us have been diminished as children. We've been incredibly impacted by being children. Something happened. Names were said. Jokes were made. Everything about us was judged growing up. Our shape, size, color, the color of our hair, our eyes, the shape of our nose, the size of our head. It might have been our family was included in that judgment, our class, where we lived, what car our family drove, how nice our house was, or how ugly our house was. Childhood is a minefield. And we all walked it. Some of the kids outside are still walking it. That's what gives us a desire to create a safe haven, an affirming place for our children. So, Zacharias was diminished. It made him want to be the big man, the powerful one. And that reaction stifles his life and his freedom and his own self-sovereignty. If we don't explore ourselves and our relationship with who we are, our whole story, not just bits of it, we will transmit that pain rather than transform it. What we see in the world is the ongoing transmittal of pain that hasn't been embraced, that hasn't been transformed. I believe this story is about being healed. So if you want wonder, joy, creativity, imagination, playfulness, laughter, freedom, those are all elements of the child. But to interact with those, you often have to interact with the complete child. The child who was hurt. The child who was in pain. The child who had to bury a lot of things growing up. The diminished stature of a child is something that invites that level of pain and exclusion, that disinheritance that lack of belonging, that desire to be someone you are not, all take shape at a very early age. There's a wonderful book by Merrill Jordan. He was a professor of mine. And he actually wrote a book called Taking on the Gods. If you want to know what idolatry is in the modern era, it's worshiping that initial, powerful, painful experience you have. Because that is God. And that God shapes you and forms you and then compels you to act and move in ways that are protective throughout life. And so that's a God. And that God rules until you take on the God. It's an idol. And he felt that all of his pastoral counseling throughout his years was boiled down to taking on the gods, finding who was being worshipped in every activity, thought, anxiety, depression, mindset, choice, all that stuff that flows out of an inaccurate view of the God that has power over you. And the true God who loves, accepts, welcomes, transforms, heals. That's what the story, I believe, is about. You know, it's like Zacchaeus steps up on the witness stand. Do you promise to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God? In a way, that is amazing, because our world is filled with half-truths and therefore falsehoods. And so to be able to have the courage to look at ourselves truthfully is incredibly challenging, but ultimately fulfilling. We start every service this way, the collect of purity. We pray to God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid. You know what that means? It means we have secrets. And we admit it. We admit it right at the beginning. I've got secrets. And those secrets are evidence of some level of vulnerability that is hard for me to embrace about my story. And yet that is where Jesus meets Zacchaeus, in a vulnerable place, up on a tree. And just imagine what that's like. Maybe you've had experiences like that. I know I've had many of them throughout my life where I've been welcomed, said, you belong. You belong here. That should be a statement, core statement of who we are as a community. You're welcome. You belong. This is yours. This is your place. Everything about you, we welcome. We welcome you without judgment. You can be a part. And when that experience happens, when you are seen and you feel smiled upon and loved, it's transformative. That's where the change comes from. Not from Bible bashing or judgments or political statements. It comes from that level of transformation. So, the world is a mess. And of late, I've begun to look at all these leaders as wounded children. I mean, some of them, it's so obvious, don't you think? I mean, to lie, cheat, steal, be conspiracy theories, anything, any way you can get to a story that keeps you from your pain and from your connection to other people, your connection to yourself, and your connection to God. And so there's a battle over the story. What's part of the story and what's not?
let's burn some books. Let's get them out of the libraries, because that doesn't agree with our story, with our morality, so-called. That doesn't agree with where we feel safe and higher than thou. That's the sign of a wounded child. That is what children do. And so I suppose I take some solace in working on myself, because I do believe this stuff emanates, that when we work with our story, we share our story, and it's hard. There are parts of my story I've buried for years. But you know what? As we mine all of that wealth, and it's wealth, the suffering produces compassion. But it has to start with us. We have to be compassionate. We have to step back, look at ourselves, and say, that hurt because of another experience I had. And it's part of a process of growth. It's why Jesus said, you cannot enter the kingdom of God unless you become as a child. What do you think that means? It means we are children. And ultimately, we return to the place we knew and perhaps know it for the first time. So, Maya Angelou used to say, the most painful thing in the world is to have a story that hasn't been told. What's your story? What is your story? Are you writing it? Which chapter are you in? Can you read it with a sense of compassion for all you've been through, for all you're going through? So your assignment this week, find a tree. Now, there's a disclaimer here. I don't want to be responsible for anybody falling out of a tree. But you know, there's a lot of trees. Our labyrinth is shaped like a tree. Go walk the labyrinth. Wander through the story of your life. That's what a labyrinth is. It's walking through various parts of your life. You can do that also in your mind, in your prayer. But visit that story again. Work on that story. Because I believe that transformation that's offered with this example of Jesus, seeing deeply into Zacchaeus, is the energy, the power, and the joy of transformation. And when we're transformed, we don't transmit the pain. We embrace it, and it becomes a source of healing, joy, and compassion.
community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all of those who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for Iglesia Anglicana de Chile. In the Diocese of Prayer, we pray for All Saints San Leandro, for the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel, and all who seek the truth.
For Michael Curry, our presiding bishop, Mark Andres, our bishop, our diocese, our deanery, the vestry, wardens, clergy, and staff of St. John's, and for all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God in the church.
We pray for the special needs and concerns of this congregation, remembering this week in our cycle of prayer, Pat Toomey, Aiden, Alice, Gilbert Atagika, and family, Ed and Katie Bonzi, Steve Book and the Book family, Bernadette Chi, Chris, Scott Christensen, Daniel, Dinah, Glennis and Jim, Sandra Davidson, Nick DeGroot, Adriana Derenak, and Mark Pitts, Elizabeth Ann, Fred Felder, for Paul Pelosi and for those suffering from political threats and violence, for victims of gun violence, for an end to gun violence, for victims of persecution, and especially for those suffering in and from the Ugandan conflict. Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, remembering this week, Carly Daly, Jim Bennett, David, Joan Cole, Chikayo Kawakimi, Larry Lim, and Barbara Derenick. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Who put their trust in you.
O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people in the multitude of your mercies. Look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, a lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins for our Lord Jesus Christ, and strengthen you in all goodness by the power of the Holy Spirit. Keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace be with you.
Peaceful.
Peace. Here you become the banner bearer.
I
We have a couple of announcements. Mary.
Hi, I'm Mary Dexter. I don't know. Next Sunday, we will celebrate All Saints at church. And a few years ago, we used to have our own sort of Day of the Dead. And so we're going to make a little ofrenda at the back altar there. And you are welcome to bring photographs or trinkets of those that you have loved and lost. And so that we can remember them on All Saints Day. Thanks.
Thank you, Mary. Is there another announcement? I don't think so. Okay. A really amazing, it's an amazing observance, All Saints. And we'll invite all of you, we'll have a chance during the procession up and back from the altar to stop and mention the names of those you're remembering, which is very grounding, very meaningful, and celebratory of the people we have loved and lost. So please know that. We will also, next Sunday and the Sunday after that, our two pledge Sundays. Those are opportunities for you to process your pledge forward and offer it at the altar if you would like to do so. After that, we don't accept any pledges. I can say that because Jim's not here in the choir today. We accept them anytime, but that's especially meaningful. Time to do that together. And if you've already done it online, don't worry, because I've already done it online and other people have. We will have little cards of gestures, offerings to bring forward that will be in your bulletins. And so you can still participate in that even though it's been all technologically slick. So, and we have an anniversary. Are there birthdays, anniversaries, transitions? I know we have one anniversary. Okay. Laura? Is it birthday? Laura's birthday? Susan? Birthday. Great to see you, Susan. Welcome. Sylvia? Birthday. You know, I'm moving down this way. There's a reason for that. I'm taking you all out for coffee. Let's go. No, actually, we're coming back here because it's Barbara and Tom's, you want to say how number?
How many? 70.
70th anniversary. I'm so glad you're here. Amazing. So we've got birthdays and an anniversary to celebrate.
Thank you.
You bet. Okay. Please send our love to Tom. Let's join together in the prayer in your bulletin on page 12. Let us pray. O God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on your servants as they begin another year. Grant that they may grow in wisdom and grace and strengthen their trust in your goodness all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. With joy-filled hearts, offer the fruits of our life and labor to God.
What?
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise.
Glory to you forever and ever.
At your command, all things came to be, vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses in this fragile earth, our island home.
By your will, they were created and have had their being.
From the primal elements, you brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against one another.
Have mercy, Lord, for we are sinners.
Again and again, you called us to return. Through prophets and sages, you revealed your righteous law. And in the fullness of time, you sent your only son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace.
By his blood, you reconciled us. By his wounds, we are healed.
Therefore, we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope to proclaim with them your glory in their unending hymn. God, we who have been redeemed by him and made a new people by water and the Spirit, now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption and offering to you this sacrifice of thanksgiving, we celebrate his death and resurrection as we await the day of his coming. Lord God of our fathers and mothers, God of Abraham and Sarah, Isaac and Rebekah, Jacob, Leah and Rachel, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this Holy Communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name.
Risen Lord, be healed to us in the breaking of the bread.
Accept these prayers and praises, God, through Jesus Christ, our great high priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit, your church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven,
as we forgive
Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. All are welcome at this table. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, We thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, the honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Now, as you go forth into the world to continue living your story, may you not leave behind the chapters of learning, the stories along the way, and the lessons that go with them. May they bring you compassion and joy that you can bring to those who are around you and even unto the world. And the blessing of God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer be with you now and evermore. Amen.
Rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia.